Not only is the image inseparable from a before and an after, which belong to it, which are not to be confused with preceding and subsequent images. No, this before and after belong to the image. There is an inherent relationship of before and after. This is not strung together series like the cells in a film, but there is a wholeness to this kind of temporal movement of before and after. In addition, the image tips over into a past and a future of which the present is now only an extreme limit, which is never given. The present is a limit. Nothing present is given. There is a movement. And the present consists in this movement into a past and future. The present is a tension between past and future. The present isn't there in a simple sense. I'm reading here from Deleuze's book, Cinema 2, The Time Image. In this book, in these books, the cinema books, Deleuze is examining cinema as an art of movement and an art of time, an art of thinking about movement and time, rethinking movement and time. And really, he is comparing different types of cinematic expressions to forms of thinking in the history of philosophy. For instance, the movement image and pre-war film, Deleuze is making an analogy to ancient philosophy. If we think of Aristotle's primary concept is movement. Essentially, all movements, all particular movements, or all individual movements, everything that is moving within the field of perception can be traced back to a prime mover. Simply a chain of reasoning. You know, if the motion of the rock that I throw is caused by the motion of my arm, the motion of my arm is caused by the energy in my body, which derives itself from having been born and the movement of my parents' life. You can trace each movement back in this chain of causes to the idea that there has to be a prime movement. And this is just like Christian theology. God has to be the first beginning, the first mover. So the movement image is this art of experiencing the world as movements. When Deleuze reaches the time image, he's talking about a moment in film where, after the trauma of World War II, cinematic art changes, becomes more self-conscious, becomes more subjective, concerned with subjectivity, concerned with reflection, questioning. And at this moment, Deleuze sees a shift to very similar to the shift that takes place in Western thought with modern philosophy, particularly in Kant. Let's say beginning with Descartes, but then reaching a height in Kant, where Kant changes the whole perspective of philosophy, the whole account of what is, metaphysics. Rather than everything deriving from a movement and having an objective character, Kant now conceives our primary sense of the world as subjective, as really rooted in us. We don't really know what is out there. All we know is that in our reflection, in our mind, we take in the sense impressions, and then we reconstruct the world in our reflection. And this is a kind of crisis, but it's also a kind of moment where human beings become more creative, because we become aware that we are stringing out of our stringing narratives together, we are putting the world together. So there's a kind of advance over ancient philosophy and over sheer movement, over cinema involved, you know, that focuses on movement. There's an advance here, more sophisticated understanding, but this is not a completely wholesale advance in Deleuze's eyes. He's a postmodern philosopher, and so in a sense he's not content with this subjectivity, this subjectivism, and so he wants to see it as problematic, an advance, but a problematic advance. We have to reconcile, this disparity between the subjective disposition of modern thinking and time consciousness with the older and something we still long for, a world of movement where the world is anchored in the prime, a prime mover in God, in a real grounded sense of the world as anchoring us. And this is the difference between the movement image and the time image. Thank you.